Good evening. My name is Dennis Walcott, and I'm the president and CEO of the Queens Public Library. And welcome to another one of our evening series in talking to important people and informing you, the public, on what's happening in their respective worlds. And tonight we have a very important person, a person who has been in the news. Matter of fact, was part of the mayor's press conference today, which we will talk about. And to me, he is a pivotal person in making sure that we as a city and as a country stay healthy. And that's Dr. Dave Choksi. And before I give you his bio, I have to say this one thing about the doctor. While the doctor is a very important person, and we'll talk about all the issues that he's being addressing now, he has a more important person in his household, a person who is serving the public in a totally different way. And doctor, with no disrespect to you, to me, your wife is at even a higher level because she is a public school teacher. And so I just want to say to her, thank you virtually for all that she's doing for our public school students, because our public school teachers are just so important in our life. So thank you to your wife and to all the public school teachers who are serving our students through these very challenging times. So doctor, welcome. And before I go into the questions, just want to give a little background. You were recently appointed as commissioner. I know it seems like probably maybe 4 years ago now, but recently appointed commissioner. And prior to that, you were at one of my favorite agencies, the Health and Hospitals Corporation. And with Health and Hospital Corporation, you were in charge of a very important area dealing with, was it child populations or children's populations? And
it was population health, including children, but across the lifespan, yes.
Across the lifespan. And you are a Rhodes Scholar as well. You have been involved with Hurricane Katrina and also Sandy. You were part of FEMA and coming into New York City as a representative, I think, of the Obama administration to work with the city back in 2012 as well. So you are very familiar with the city, you're part of the city, and we in Queens can claim you for our own because you're one of our residents and we're very proud to have you as a resident. So again, thank you for being on the show and talking to the public, and we appreciate everything that you, your wife, and your family are doing as well. So why don't we start
with— Thank you so much for having me.
Oh, my pleasure. And I think you might know this, but at Queens Public Library, we also have turned a number of our libraries into testing sites as well.
Yes.
So to date, we've had roughly 27,000 people who have gone through our doors being tested for the virus. So we always value our partnership with the city and say thank you for all of your hard work. So doctor, why don't you just start out by telling us not just about your background, but I think some of the important things that you're engaged in right now.
Well, first, I just want to say thank you, Dennis. Thanks for having me. Thanks for allowing me to speak to everyone tonight. I am a real admirer of your work and what the Queens Public Library does on so many different levels. First, you know, I'm like you. I'm the son of immigrants, and where I grew up in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, the library, the public library, was such an important window for me into you know, the worlds that that I was not able to, you know, get exposed to, but for which the library was a portal in so many ways. It was really the seed of the dreams, you know, that I had for myself, my family, my career. And I know that it represents that for so many people in Queens as well. And I'm glad that you mentioned what the library is doing, you know, to support COVID-19 efforts. I think it's another great example of how libraries are, you know, not just places where people go to learn or exchange ideas, although of course that's important. They're really institutional pillars. You know, they're anchors in the ways that you know, that you have demonstrated. So so thanks for letting me just say a couple of
Thank
notes.
You, sir. About I appreciate life. That.
And you know, I'll start by you know, by saying that for me, you know, the way that I think about myself is I'm a primary care doctor with a public health heart. You know, I had the
and you're still practicing as well, I understand.
Not as much in the last few months because of the pandemic, but yes, I look forward to getting back to it as soon as possible in the new year. I've been taking care of people at Bellevue Hospital for the last 7 years. And I have to say thank you also for acknowledging my wife, who is a public school teacher in Queens, now actually an assistant principal at a public school in Queens. And I just want to share to give you a glimpse. There were so many times after, you know, long days for both of us, me taking care of patients and her doing the work that you mentioned in our schools. And I would come home and I would say, you know, you probably did at least as much for the health of your students as I did for the health of my patients. And I really believe that with respect to how education and health are inherently linked. And the final thing I'll say, just, you know, by way of introduction is that all of this is coming together in a very powerful and, as you know, an often tragic way during this pandemic. The ways in which all of us are interconnected, the ways in which the different parts of society, whether it's public health and education or our libraries and, you know, thinking about the essential workers that we rely upon. One of the things that I hope will be a lasting effect of this terrible time that we've experienced is a deep understanding of those interconnections that all of us have. And so I see part of my job as navigating us as well as I can, you know, for the entire city, to a point where we can all look back and say, hey, we learned something about ourselves and our city in this pandemic, and we're gonna use it to strengthen the way that we have going forward.
Just to pick up on that theme for 1 second, I think part of what you're talking about and what we've seen, the people banding together and the collective spirit in trying to address the pandemic and making sure that all of us are safe, and the important role, whether you're in the school system, whether you're a commissioner, whether you're the mayor, or just a person on the street, making sure we have a vested interest in making sure that all of us are healthy. So I totally agree with you, sir.
Thank you. That's well said. And, you know, this is a time now because of what we're seeing with the resurgence, you know, with cases increasing and hospitalizations going up again, where we have to think about that and think about our actions as being inherently related to what our neighbors and our community members will experience.
Especially as we approach the holidays as well, because, I mean, we talk about it here at the library and I talk about it to a number of people as far as making sure that you're not necessarily looking to others, but you're looking to yourself on how you can make sure your behavior supports others and makes other folks healthy as well. And I think that's part of the whole challenge for people, because we did go through a period of time over the summer where things went down, and I follow it every day, and a number of fatalities were in single digits and maybe 10 or 11. And now we're back up to the hundreds and it's just skyrocketing again, not just here in New York City, but across the country. So what is the health department's role in addressing this, and especially you as commissioner?
Yeah, well, we take our role very seriously, you know, with respect to bearing responsibility for how we navigate through the COVID-19 pandemic. You know, my starting point is always around the core values of our department. We have three core values that we keep coming back to, but particularly in difficult times like these. And those are science, equity, and compassion. And each of them is very important in and of themselves, but together they flesh out, you know, what our mission is, which is to protect and promote the health of New Yorkers. You know, in some ways, I feel like my job is, you know, not easy, but at least clear with respect to what our charge is, and that's to prevent suffering and to save lives. And we do everything that we possibly can, from putting out public health guidance, for example, around the holidays, as you mentioned, to making sure that we're looking at the data to inform our response, to doing, you know, very tangible things, whether it's increasing the amount of testing that's available, or now rolling out, you know, what will be a historic vaccination campaign for New Yorkers.
And with, I see you on commercials all the time. And so in addition to the commercials, what other ways the health department trying to make sure it gets out to the public, especially tied into the mayor's announcement around vaccinations today and what you and the deputy mayor and the mayor were talking about. So how does the health department play a role in that? And what are some of the messages you would like to reinforce and drive home with our audience?
Thank you for that opportunity. Ultimately, I think about this as we have to make sure that our messages, our public health guidance, are more contagious than the virus itself. Only if we succeed in doing that will we be able to combat what is such a formidable foe, as we've seen, in terms of how pernicious this virus is. So we use every channel that's available to us, whether it's media or the PSAs that you mentioned, or making sure that we're handing out flyers and palm cards, often in a very, boots on the ground way. Sometimes you'll see our staff in your communities, handing out masks along with that information. So we try to do everything that we can. But I also want to mention that it's not just about us, although we will work as hard as we possibly can to get those messages out. Our job is equally to empower everyone to take it on for themselves, to be, the person who's going to spread that message, who may actually start that difficult conversation around the holidays to say, hey, I know it's our Christmas tradition for everyone, to gather from all different parts of the United States, but maybe we shouldn't do that this year, given everything that's happening. And so equally, our job is to activate people, empower them, so that each of them can be ambassadors for public health.
And in doing that, though, and especially in New York City, I would imagine it's a major challenge because, one, we're so large, we're so diverse, and then we're the home to airports. And here in the borough of Queens, we have JFK, we have LaGuardia, not that far away is Newark. And I saw a figure, was it a couple of days ago, about the number of people who have been boarding planes and the travel that's taking place. So how do you manage that from a health perspective, especially when you're talking about the number of people who might be coming in or the people going back and forth? What is the role of the health department and the city, for that matter, in trying to address that?
That's absolutely right. And, I have to say, as you mentioned, I'm a very proud Queens resident. My wife was born and raised in Queens. Her family is one of those only in Queens stories. Actually, through a family matchmaker, my mother-in-law and father-in-law met at JFK Airport. Because they both worked there, and a family member set them up. There's so much to appreciate about the cultural tapestry that is Queens, and there's so much strength in it, as we know, and we get to appreciate every day. But what you're mentioning is one of the challenges that comes with it, the huge amount of just flow of people, that occurs in Queens and New York City as a whole, because of our airports, because of our rail hubs, all of those things. And so we've been taking a hard look at this for months, to make sure that when people are traveling, that we're being very vigilant about ensuring that people adhere to the quarantine requirements. I've issued commissioner's orders related to those quarantine requirements to make sure that people are adhering to them, and doing the things that we know will help to make sure that if someone is traveling and spreading the virus, that they get tested, and that they isolate or quarantine as appropriate. But I have to say, I am worried about it, particularly during the holiday season, as we've mentioned, because cases are on the rise, because, we saw after Thanksgiving, for example, a spike in cases in New York City, and I'm worried about that again, after this holiday season. So we all have to take it upon ourselves to do the things that have worked over the last few months, to stay home and not travel, but also, what we call the five actions that everyone needs to take, which is keeping your distance, 6 feet of distance, wearing your mask at all times, both indoors and outdoors, washing your hands, staying home if you're feeling ill and getting tested. And those are the things that have worked. They worked over the summer, as you pointed out, you know, to get it to very low levels of spread. We've got to rely on them, even as we look ahead to hopefully a new reality in 2021 with the vaccine.
I would just add one little piece to what you just said. It is not just wearing your mask, wearing your mask where it covers your nose as well. Because unfortunately, there are a number of people who have their masks on, but it only covers their mouth and their nose is totally exposed. And I think that type of consciousness raising is so important because people may not just know and they're not doing out of any type of malice. They're just not aware because they think they have their masks on.
You're absolutely right. And thank you for pointing that out. And look, I have to acknowledge, I get it. You know, people are tired. Unfortunately, we're all tired, but this virus isn't tired of us. And, you know, that's what leads to some of the challenges, whether it's, you know, people not following our holiday guidance or not wearing masks appropriately or not, you know, in certain settings. We've all got to dig deep right now and also help and support one another so that we do take those actions that we need to.
So you just said the virus is not tired of us. So why don't we pick up on that and talk about the new strain? And I mean, it's gotten obviously a lot of attention for a host of different reasons. Can you talk to us about the new strain and its implications for, say, New York City?
Sure. You know, this is a development that I'm watching with concern. And I'm sure other people have heard about it. But just to, you know, start from the basics on this, there's a new strain of the virus that has been identified primarily in the United Kingdom, in England, that appears to be more infectious than other strains of the virus that causes COVID-19. It doesn't appear that that this strain is any more deadly or causes severe illness, but the evidence that we have right now is that it's more transmissible, meaning it spreads more easily than other strains of the virus. We have not, in the United States, found evidence that the strain is being picked up as yet, either in the United States or in New York City, from the samples that we're testing. But it's very likely that we will see it. You know, just because of how much travel has already occurred all around the world, and particularly, you know, for New York City. What I can say about it just briefly is that even though this strain is more infectious, the same things that I described, those five actions, they're just as effective, you know, for that new strain of the virus. And it makes it even more important for us to follow that right now.
Now, what I saw also in the papers, and you talked earlier about science, is the science showing that it will infect children more than the current strain of the virus, or is that still too early to tell?
It's still very preliminary. And, you know, our understanding of this is evolving by the day. We're tracking it very closely. Our public health laboratory, that's the labs that fall under the health department, we are doing the genetic testing, you know, to be able to identify those strains if they appear in New York City. But all of the underlying science here is still preliminary and waiting to be, you know, truly unfolded. There are some indications that it may be that children are more susceptible to that strain, but that's not definitive as yet.
And one of the facts basically is that there are always new strains of virus, whether it's the flu virus or any other type of virus. They're constantly mutating in a variety of different ways. So I remember one year, maybe it was several years ago, that the flu vaccine that was administered didn't match up to the particular mutation of that type of flu. And so that whole batch basically was useless for the population. Do I remember that correctly?
Yes, you said it very well. That's exactly right. It's a very important point to make, which is that, you know, different strains of the virus have existed long before we started reading these headlines about what's happening in the United Kingdom. Just because there is a slightly different strain of a virus doesn't necessarily mean that it's going to be any more infectious or any more dangerous. But we have additional evidence from England that indicates that this particular strain may be more more easily spread.
Before we talk about vaccinations and the program the city has in place, can you talk a little bit about the why it's increasing such a rapid rate? Is it because we're now going into the winter season, even though down in Florida and Texas and other warm states, it's increasing rapidly? Is it because of the relaxed nature of society? And as you said earlier, people are tired of it. Is it all the above and people just gotten lax in the basic role that they should be playing in preventing the virus?
I think it is a combination of all of those things that you mentioned. You know, we know with respiratory viruses like the coronavirus that they tend to get worse during the winter time because people are spending more time indoors, because the humidity of the air changes and allows the virus to be transmitted more easily. And then, yes, you know, some of those other factors that you mentioned are certainly contributors as well, you know, pandemic fatigue. And unfortunately, the way that it works is once you start to see more cases, it's much more likely for that to continue increasing rather than to go in the other direction. So our job is to try to arrest, you know, that increase and drive the numbers back down. But that's going to take, you know, very concerted effort. I will say, you know, compared to other parts of the United States, because New Yorkers are, you know, taking the actions that they need to, in large part, we're not seeing quite the same level, particularly of hospitalizations and serious illness as in other parts of the country. But I am still worried, particularly given the case numbers, you know, which are now about 3,000 cases per day in New York City. That's far too high. And that means some proportion of them will eventually, you know, turn into hospitalizations or, unfortunately, and most tragically, into the deaths of our fellow workers.
So I know at the various sites that we have that are administering the test, and my church also is administering the test and has been doing it for a long period of time. When I passed by my church today, the line was around the block. And then when I go by our libraries, the lines are around the block. And so now they're a lot longer. And so more people are taking it seriously as far as getting tested. And my wife and I, for example, made an agreement that we'll get tested alternating weeks. So that way we'll know not at the same time, but if one is positive or the other, and hopefully we won't be, to try to do it that way. So, I mean, I think I would assume that the number of tests is increasing rapidly as well.
Yes. Well, one of the things that I'm very proud of for New York City is that we have some of the greatest testing capacity, not just in the United States, but in the entire world. And so, yes, you know, the number of tests has risen quite a bit in the last few months. You know, upwards of 50,000 tests per day on many days, and that's a good thing. That means more people are finding out, you know, if they're positive or negative. Right. Most importantly, if they're positive, you know, making sure that they're isolating so we can break the chains of transmission right there.
So now, one of the pillars you talked about earlier was equity. And making sure that things are done in a way that is across the board and even for all population, and there's equity. So when we talk about vaccinations, that's an area that's really been focusing on equity and the concerns, especially in the Black community, as far as vaccines and getting tested and making sure the administration of vaccines were done in an equitable way. Can you talk a little bit about what you guys announced today and how you are putting in place a system that deals with equity, but also deals with the horrors of the past for the Black community and making sure that vaccines are something that people not just take seriously, but move to have it done as well?
Yes. Well, thanks. This is an incredibly important conversation and one that, frankly, we will need to continue having over the coming weeks and months as our vaccination campaign proceeds. But as you pointed out, equity is just as important a pillar for our vaccination efforts as the science or the logistics, you know, of delivering the vaccine or you know, tracking the data to understand who's actually getting it, the public communication around it. So we're thinking about this as one of the core ways in which we are holding ourselves accountable, you know, for having a successful vaccination campaign. But what does it mean? You know, how are we actually going to do that? And I think that that, to your point, requires both looking backwards as well as looking forwards. Looking backwards, we have to reckon with the pernicious history of racism, of structural racism in our country that has created the inequities that we have seen, certainly over the last few months with respect to COVID-19, but really over years and decades and centuries in this country. And so for me, when I look backward, that propels me to say, it's not just about earning trust or building trust going forward. It's about recognizing why we have to think about our job as being worthy of the trust of the people, you know, that we're trying to earn. Excuse me for just one moment.
Yeah, I saw the change.
We have an auto off switch for the light.
See, but before you go on, I'm nervous because my lights in here are connected to lights outside. So when our custodians walk around, you know, they want to shut off the light. So if I go dark, that means they're doing their job. But unfortunately, I will have to get up as well. So yes, sir, you were talking about something really serious now.
Mm-hmm. No. So yes. So just to, you know, pick up on that. So that's what we have to do when we recognize, looking backwards, that we're in this moment for a reason. You know, the same way that I think about it for the patients that I've taken care of, and understanding their values and their beliefs, but also the legacy of their interactions with the healthcare system, of their family members' interactions with the healthcare system, all of that has to put us in a position where we ask ourselves, are we doing everything we possibly can to be worthy of the trust of the people that we're serving? And that's what takes us to, you know, okay, how do we do that looking
right.
forward?
Right.
And just to, you know, briefly touch on this, I will say, it is something, again, to just, you know, kind of take it from the exam room to the community. What I always have started with in terms of taking care of patients is you start with humility, you start with listening to people. And if you do that, that is what puts you in a place to actually take care of someone. Humility in the context of a community vaccination campaign recognizes that, you know, we talked about public messaging before, maybe it's not me who's the best messenger. So let's not just think about the message, but let's think about who the messenger is. And particularly when we're talking about people who are already trusted in neighborhoods and communities, it's going to be faith leaders and community organizers, the people who have been in places, again, for years and decades, who have earned trust over that period of time.
Librarians.
Librarians, yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. Uh-huh. And having the reflex to partner with those people and those institutions is what will characterize our response.
So when you talk about the issue of equity, as you indicated, you have to take a look at the past and the racism, especially the structural racism that existed, but it's not solely just around health. It's the inequities of our society and how people view that, and really unpackaging those inequities so people understand from a comprehensive point of view of some of the challenges that we have to face to make sure people trust. Because it is all about trust and how you build the trust and confidence in not just the Black community, but communities in general and what it means to society. So you, the city, we, the community-based organizations, faith-based leaders, have to really tap into making sure people have a clearer understanding of what it's about and making sure we explain it in a way where people understand the value. Because, you know, the whole thing connected to the vaccine, I was doing research around polio. And because I remember my cousin, she was in an iron lung back in the day as a result of polio. and just the eradication of polio and how that evolved over a period of time. And it's building the trust in people so that way they can take the necessary steps. And it's going to be a very hard but comprehensive and important effort that you're undertaking.
Well, thank you. I really appreciate the way that you articulated that, and particularly the connection between trust and equity. I think the way that we have been discussing this is that trust is an essential ingredient for turning a vaccine into a vaccination. You know, that the scientists have done their job. You know, they've delivered a miraculous vaccine that is safe and effective. And now, you know, it's our job to turn those vaccines into vaccinations. But that's not going to happen unless we address trust in the ways that you've described.
So let me pick up on that point, if I may, because the vaccine was created in such a rapid fashion. And so when we talk about trust, can you take a couple of moments to talk about why you trust the vaccine and what was involved in getting the vaccine to this particular point, especially coming from a health perspective?
Yes, thank you for the question. It's an important one. And I recognize that people have witnessed this over the last few months and said, wow, this was a very fast timeline, you know, to actually have the vaccine created and then authorized by the federal government. I recognize that. What I want to convey is that the technology underlying the vaccine, what's known as mRNA technology, is something that's been in development for many, many years. And was something that was able to be brought to bear at the very beginning of the pandemic, you know, in February, to be able to develop and then test the vaccine in very large studies to figure out whether the vaccine was safe and effective. So the Pfizer vaccine, for example, was tested in over 44,000 individuals and was found to be very safe. And also remarkably effective, over 95% effective. The Moderna vaccine, that's the second one that just started to get rolled out this week, similarly was tested in over 30,000 people and was found to be very safe and effective. So these are, you know, the most important thing that I can tell you is that, I have reviewed the studies myself. I've looked at the science. When it's my turn, I will get the vaccine because I believe it is a very good vaccine. When my family members are eligible, same thing. I will be strongly recommending it to them as well.
So talk about eligibility then, because I mean, you hit on an important point that a lot of people are wondering about as far as the various categories and eligibility, and then how in a massive city, even though I just read the article in the Times, what was it, several days ago about the administering was it the measles vaccine?
Smallpox.
Well, smallpox, thank you. Smallpox vaccine, and how it was done in a very comprehensive way, even though the city then is totally different than the city now. But what's the plan as far as the rollout? And say for a person like yourself, when would your demographic per se qualify for being eligible to take the vaccine?
That's right. These are important questions. I know they're on everyone's mind as well. Let me kind of give you the big picture first, and then I'm happy to dive into the details with you.
Sure.
So the supply of the vaccines right now is limited. And so that's why we have to prioritize in the way that you're describing. But let me give you the roadmap. There are generally three phases with respect to how the vaccine will be rolled out across the country. We're in the first phase right now, where there's very limited supply of the vaccine and demand, you know, outstrips that supply. So we have to think about who's most at risk, both of exposure as well as severe illness if they were to contract COVID-19. So that's the first phase. The second phase, which will likely be a few months down the road, potentially in spring of 2021, is when the supply of the vaccine starts to catch up to the demand, and we'll be able to expand out, you know, much more significantly the people who are eligible and able to get the vaccine. And then the third phase, which will likely be around the middle of 2021, is when we have so much supply of the vaccine that it will be available to anyone who wants it in the general public. So in this first phase where we are right now, we're going to have to methodically go group by group. The federal government issues recommendations about who's prioritized, and then the state, New York State, gives the final, sort of guidance on what those phases look like. Right now, we're focusing on high-risk healthcare workers. These are the people that we've relied on to take care of ourselves and our fathers and mothers and grandparents in the hospitals, in the emergency departments, and intensive care units. And then this week, we also started with the residents and staff of nursing homes as well. So that's the very first group. It will take us a few weeks just to, get beyond that. And then we'll go to other healthcare workers and start to broaden out the circle from there.
So now the part I don't understand, as you broaden the net and supply becomes greater, say with Walgreens and CVS, will they be the ones to administer to the general public, or will it be so much of a supply that you can go to your doctor? Because when you talk about trust also, it's the trust of your doctor versus the trust of CVS, and I'm not knocking them at all. So how does that work as far as supply becomes more plentiful, the distribution to the pharmacies versus the doctors and the administering of the vaccine?
I'm so glad you made that connection, because it's something that I try to emphasize when I talk about this as well, which is it's not just about access, although that's true. It's about accessing it in a place and from a person whom you trust. And so the more that we can leverage those channels that already exist, whether it's you going to the primary care doctor who's been taking care of you for years, or someone else going to the pharmacist whom they have a relationship with, we want to use all of those channels that already exist for people to get vaccines when they do become more broadly available. I will say, at some point we will have it available so that people can get it from the places that they trust, a community-based clinic, their primary care doctor, their pharmacy. But then we may have additional supply that we want to make accessible to the public. And so we as the health department are actively planning for that as well, setting up additional points of access across the city in partnership, with many of our city government colleagues, and planning for the fact that ultimately we want to turn vaccines into vaccinations safely, effectively, equitably, but also quickly, and trying to balance all of those considerations.
So with that being said, that intersection you think might take place around the middle of 2021, because I think part of the challenge for both people as well as for government entities is setting realistic expectations, because you'll have people really rightfully excited, as long as they're convinced that it'll work, about vaccines now being on the market. But managing the supply and demand expectations, I would imagine, is a very unique challenge.
Yes, I mean, we've never seen anything like this before, including in those historic vaccination campaigns that you mentioned,
right,
whether it was polio or smallpox. And remember, we're doing this at a moment where everyone has to keep the physical distancing up, keep wearing their masks, and we're seeing a resurgence, in cases. So yes, there's a lot to balance here, with respect to how to do this thoughtfully and well. But those principles that I mentioned are going to be our touchstones to make sure that that we try to strike the right balance between getting it out and communicating to people about it, but also keeping an eye on doing it as safely as possible and as equitably as possible.
There's one other variable also that I recently saw or heard about, which will put a challenge to, I guess, the community as well, is the intersection of the lack of supply of health professionals, since the health professionals are basically concentrating their time within the hospitals and the other medical institutions, And so that availability of staff to help out is going to be really, at least for now, in somewhat short supply because they're meeting the demands of what's happening with the increase, correct?
That is true. And that's another reason why trying to get our case numbers down and trying to get our hospitalizations back down is critically important. For the reasons that you mentioned around staffing, but also because we know that when COVID hospitalizations go up, all of the other things that people seek care for from their clinics and their doctors, those start to go down and people start to skip, you know, their routine care or not show up in the emergency room, something that they may actually need care for. I'm very worried about this because I saw it in March and April, you know, as a doctor myself, and I saw that people who really needed care for something not related to COVID were staying away, either because they were afraid or because they thought, you know, they might not get the best care possible. And for example, you know, we saw the levels of routine vaccinations go down around the country, and that has a very tangible long-term impact. So one of the messages that I've really tried to spread is, even though we're advising people, you know, to stay at home as much as you can, stick with your household, one of the things that is really essential is if you need medical care, including routine medical care for things like diabetes or depression, it is safe to go to the clinic, or if you really need to, you know, to go to the emergency room or hospital, because those are some of the health impacts that are reverberating from COVID-19.
I volunteered at Queens Hospital Center for a period of time, which was an eye-opening experience. And one of the things that I think was a major challenge of the many challenges was the managing of your pharmacy bill, where a number of people who have a variety of illnesses or issues have a number of medications they have to take and affordability of those medications. And people making forced choices as far as maybe this month I'll get these four prescriptions filled and then the next month getting the other four filled. Will people be charged at any point for the vaccines that are being administered at this particular point in time?
The short answer is no. The federal government has made a commitment that the vaccine will be free for individuals. And New York City is gonna do everything that we have to do to first hold the federal government to that commitment and then support where we need to, you know, to ensure that it's free for individuals. This includes people who don't have health insurance. It includes undocumented immigrants who are eligible for care through the NYC Care program. So the takeaway is that the vaccine will be free for New Yorkers.
So I want to pick up on two more points before we draw to an end. One is you talked about undocumented immigrants. And I know here at the library, especially when we were open for people just to come in and sit down and get services, not just grab and go services that we're offering now, you see a lot of folks, because we don't ask. We don't ask who you are, what your background is, where you're from, just you're welcome here. And how do you address the fear factor of those people who are immigrants who may be worried about going to a pharmacy for a shot or going to a health clinic or a hospital for services? And so when we talk about equity, it's not just equity within the communities of color, it's equity in making sure that people who have been fearful for the last number of years have the comfort level to also come in for a vaccination.
That's exactly right. And we have to recognize that particularly over the last few years, the growing anti-immigrant rhetoric has created, greater anxiety and fear. Again, I've seen this myself for the patients that I've taken care of at Bellevue, and Elmhurst is my neighborhood hospital, and they see similar issues as I'm sure you witnessed at Queens Hospital as well. There are a few things that we have to do. First, just communicate as clearly as possible, but again, do it through the organizations and the people that our immigrant communities already trust and already go to. You know, we've tried to do this with the NYC CARE program, and there are, you know, a number of immigrants, including undocumented immigrants, whom I've cared for through the NYC CARE program. So we're going to leverage those panels. And then we're going to need to partner, you know, with others who can make it very clear to address the specific concerns that people may have. For example, one that I want to assuage is that no information about immigration status or any other identifying information will be transmitted to the federal government. And so, you know, things like that are very important, particularly when people have been concerned because of things like the public charge rule, which has very tangible, you know, effects for people and families. So we have to be head on about making sure that we're taking on those concerns, you know, being sensitive to them, but also delivering, you know, clear information that can help to help people make the decisions that are right for them.
So the name of your agency is Department of Health and Mental Health. A lot of times it's just known as Department of Health, and you mentioned a little while ago about depression. We're in the holiday season, we're going through a pandemic, we're seeing the number of deaths increase, family members, neighbors. How do people now respond to their emotional mental health issues and challenges, and what role are you playing through your agency to help address those issues and concerns?
Thanks, and you know, something that I think about a lot, this is one of what I think of as the parallel pandemic associated with COVID-19, is all of the effects with respect to stress and trauma and mental health and substance use, which have been, you know, growing challenges for the reasons that you mentioned, and particularly because of the economic and social dislocation, you know, that so many people have experienced over the last few months. I mean, we all have to just recognize what a tough and terrible year it has been for too many of us and too many of our neighbors. You know, I was just thinking about this earlier, you know, for people who celebrate Christmas or other holidays around this time of year, we have to acknowledge that too many families will have empty chairs around their tables this year. And the grief and the trauma, you know, that's associated with that is very very real and very cascading, you know, in terms of how it affects everyone. So, you know, we're doing what we can to support New Yorkers through this, really ramping up our services. For example, 888-NYC-WELL is a phone number that people who are really struggling can call to get connected with those services. The website is also nyc.gov/NYC-WELL. These are really important resources that are available, you know, for anyone who is struggling, particularly around this time of year. But I think the other point to say about this is that, again, it's not just what we as a government or the health department can do. It's about what each of us can do. And one of the messages that I've been trying to spread is that even as we talk about physical distancing, we should, in the same breath, you know, think about social connectedness and taking that time, you know, every day to reach out to someone whom you may know is struggling because they lost a loved one or because they lost a job, you know, whatever the reason may be, and having the wherewithal for us to sort of step outside of ourselves for a moment and make sure that we're reaching out to people, because that means a lot, you know, when it comes from someone that you love. And I hope that people take that to heart during the holiday season.
We have a great team of people here at Queens Public Library. I think the world of them. They are just so respected. And one of our folks, our nurse, arranged a webinar today because we call this the Acts of Kindness Month. And we find different ways to treat people in a kind way. And we had an internal kindness approach with each other where we set up a webinar. And there were over 230 to 250 people on the webinar. And it was just talking about some of the challenges and transitions, but also the hope and some of the things they've been doing since we've been in the pandemic. And it was really a very cathartic opportunity for people to say, both whether anonymously or have their name identified through the chat room, just some of the things they were going through. And people who have lost relatives who, as you just said, will celebrate the holidays with an empty seat or empty seats as well. And finding those types of opportunities, I think, whether you're the Queens Public Library or any institution or faith-based institution, is very helpful to people because they just want people to talk to them. I mean, people, some people just started out, unfortunately, being by themselves. And as a result of that, now they're even more isolated. So finding new ways to engage people and using the virtual world and using old-fashioned phones sometimes to give people a call, I think that helps with the emotional and the mental health, and also steering people in the appropriate directions as well. So as we close, if you had two resounding messages that you wanted to say to the people who are looking at this, what would those two messages be?
Oh, what a great question. Let me think about it for a moment, Dennis.
Sure, sure.
Here are the two that are coming to mind. The first, just picking up on the great example that you shared, is let's all do everything that we can to set up virtuous cycles in our lives and in the way that we think about responding to the pandemic. What I mean by virtuous cycles are exactly what you described, you know, setting up a space or just making that phone call where you reach out to someone and you change, you know, their day by doing so. And hopefully that sets off, a chain reaction so that they reach out to someone else as well. We're really thinking about virtuous cycles, particularly with vaccination, to make it so that the healthcare workers, you know, the heroes whom we've relied on, who are now getting a shot of protection themselves, people look at that and they see that the vaccine is safe and effective, and they think about it for themselves as well. So let's all do what we can, whether we're a nurse or working at the Queens Public Library, or you know, just a neighbor or a family member, to create some virtuous cycles in the spaces that we are in. Mm-hmm. And then the second one is really, the thing that keeps me up at night these days is seeing how much people continue to suffer because of this pandemic. And we have a light at the end of the tunnel with the vaccine, but it doesn't make the tunnel any less perilous. And we have to take that to heart to pull out all the stops in these coming weeks and months to prevent as much suffering as possible, to save as many lives as possible. And you have my commitment as the health commissioner to do everything that I can, but it's gonna take all of us to redouble our efforts in this critical moment so that we can navigate into that new reality in 2021 all of our friends, colleagues, neighbors, staying as healthy as we possibly can.
So doctor, thank you for that. And also take full advantage of our public libraries, because not just Queens, you have the Brooklyn Public Library and the New York Public Library. And we have libraries, even though we're in a different mode right now, that are located in all the communities, especially when you talk about the issue of equity and the equitable application of vaccines and information. So take advantage of us as far as just getting information out. All of us have our networks that we get out to, and we reach, you think about the number of customers who have library cards. We reach millions of people. So there's an opportunity there. And as you and the city and your very, very special deputy mayor, who I think the world of, come up with new ideas, then please share them, which I know you will, because people trust their libraries. I mean, they trust the people they've developed relationships with in their local community, and where you're located, you have your library that's open as well, and another one that will be opening. And so we are always there to serve the public and to serve the city. So I just want to let you know that. So Dr. Commissioner, thank you very much. Much appreciated. And my regards to the mayor, to your colleagues, and to your family, and especially to your assistant principal as well.
Thank you so much, Dennis. Well, I will certainly take you up on your kind offer. And I'm just very grateful for the opportunity to get to speak with you and to the audience tonight. So thanks for having me.
And thank you for sharing, and have a good night. And to our Queens Public Library audience, thank you for joining us. And we'll be having more of these type of discussions as we move into 2021. Happy holiday to all of you, and be safe and enjoy yourself to the best of your ability. Thank you.